Hi, race fans, and welcome to this edition of Midwest Motorsports Review. I'm your host, Daryl Franklin. The 2002 racing season will be a busy one for the Renegade Dirt Car Racing Series, with 32 events scheduled at 18 different tracks in 10 different states, with a total available purse money of exceeding $1,300,000. Include over $300,000 in winners' purses alone. With races scheduled from Florida to Wisconsin, five new venues dot this year's schedule. Hosting the Renegade Dirt Car Series for the very first time will be Virginia Motor Speedway in Soldotna, Virginia, McKean County Raceway in East Smithport, Pennsylvania, Mountain Motor Speedway in Iceland, Kentucky, LaSalle Speedway in LaSalle, Illinois, and Farley Speedway in Farley, Iowa. June 19th marks the series debut at the LaSalle Speedway in LaSalle, Illinois, with a 50-lap main event paying $10,000 to win. Cedar Lake Speedway in New Richmond, Wisconsin welcomes back the Renegade Dirt Car Series June 21st with a $15,000 to win Master 75. Eddie Munster, many-time IMCA Modified Champion in Northeast Wisconsin, will drive the Reds excavating Chevy Super Truck for Roger Parrott of Marquette, Michigan on the Planet Pages Mid-Am Super Truck Tour. Munster, who also races a late model Wisconsin International Raceway, jumped in the Super Truck when regular pilot Rick Lemons was injured racing mini stocks. Munster was the quickest Super Truck at the USA Super Truck Nationals, but ended up second, having had to restart in the rear on a yellow flag. Parrott is playing as it goes. We'll be at the first race. We hope to run most of the races and see how he fits into Eddie's schedule. If we're near the top in the points after the first race, we may chase the whole deal. The truck will go back to one number 131 after running Lemons 00 last year. The team will be at the Hawkeye Downs, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, for the opener on Friday night, April 26th. In ASA Racing News, officials from the American Speed Association have announced a change for the 2002 ASA Racing Series schedule of events. Iliana Motor Speedway, located in Schererville, Indiana, replaces U.S. 131 Motorsports Park on the weekend of September 21st and 22nd. It's the 18th of 20 race schedules for ASA Series. I'm sure ASA will be welcomed with open arms, says Mike Muttley, Iliana Motor Speedway track promoter. The exposure to this will provide our facility tremendous. ASA brings a lot of guys our fans know, including some of our regular drivers like Pat Kelly, Dave Weltmeyer, John Brolock, Mike White. We are absolutely looking forward to this. Construction engineers at U.S. 131 Motorsports Park in Martin, Michigan found an unstable lay of earth during the excavation process, making it more costly and risky to continue with the oval track process at this time. In addition to current economic conditions, track officials have decided to delay the construction until a suitable option can be found to complete the project. The disclosure by track officials to the ASA offices late last week required ASA Racing Series to activate a contingency plan already in place, formalizing and finalizing the deal with Iliana Motor Speedway. In negotiations with ASA event date with U.S. 131 Motorsports Park last fall, we were well aware that we may need an alternate plan for a specific weekend, said ASA Executive Vice President Brian Robbins. We went so far with our discussion with U.S. 131 Motorsports Park that we stipulated a drop-dead date for the BF Goodrich tire test in an effort to allow enough time to determine whether the track would be ready for us to use by the scheduled race date of September 22nd. Robbins, along with ASA Vice President of Sales and Marketing Mike Rudwin, visited the half-mile Iliana track in July of 2001. Meeting with track promoter Mike Muttley, the discussion surrounded the possible ASA date for 2003 racing season, but also touched on the suburban Chicago Oval serving as a potential place to compete in 2002 in the event the opening appeared on the schedule. Our conversations with Mike were very positive regarding the future ASA event at Iliana, said Gredman. Mike has done a tremendous job with the facility and indicated to us that his intentions continue improvement. We discussed several specific facility accommodations we required to host an ASA event, and he indicated they are willing to move forward in that direction. At the time we met, we pretty much had our 2002 schedule in place, but we talked about possibility of a 2002 date in the event we had an opening in our schedule. It works well that the geographic of the two locations are so close. It should not cause our competitors too many problems. At this time, we'd like to welcome Dave Kamholtz to our staff. Dave had the opportunity to sit down at Performance Unlimited in McHenry, Illinois with some Lake Geneva drivers as we get ready for the 2002 season opener on April 6th at the Lake Geneva Raceway. So let's go spend some time with Dave.
CC Corso out of Johnsburg, Illinois. Rick, tell you what, you've got a lot of experience across the country in a various number of cars. You got a championship in that Mid-American Series, don't you?
Yeah, we got a championship out in the super late model division, or actually the Millennium late model division. Got a Mid-American championship, got two Lake Geneva Mid-American championships also.
And now you're looking to move into that super late model as you have the last few years. Done rather well in that, as well as picking up the Millennium Series championship last year. Who is your biggest competitor out there on the track?
Well, Landry Potter's looks like he's got the ASA deal, so he's gone this year. It kind of leaves the field somewhat open. Who knows who's coming back, who's going to be there. It'll be a tight, probably top five again finish for the top five guys. It'll be out there. It'll be a strong run for everybody. Whoever has good luck to start the year out and continue to run good should be all right. We're hoping to have a good season this year. We're coming out with two cars. Both will be super late instead of a Millennium car and a late model. We're doing a house car for performance here. We'll be running a new left-hander chassis that Denny's got a dealership with, and we'll see how that works out.
Now you got a lot of help up there in the pit area from quite a bunch of rather colorful characters. So I can't hardly spit that out. Well, who's those guys up there in the pit area?
Well, I got my crew chief, Kent Calhoun. He's been with me since I basically started racing. He works well with us, gets along with everybody. Every now and then he gets a little out of hand. We keep him in control, or I should say his wife keeps him in control. I got Jim Krein, who's been with me now for about 4 years. I got a former crew member back, Harry Mueller. He'll be out there this year. And then, of course, my sister and my brother-in-law, who came on about 3 years ago. My brother-in-law is quite a bit of the maintenance at home and the shop, and a big financial end of it, too.
And speaking of financial end of it, you got a lot of great sponsors. I know you've got a lot of sponsors who've been with you a very long time. Why don't you tell us about some of those folks?
Yeah, pretty much my sponsors have been with us almost 10 years. We have a few new ones on here or there. It starts out with Adams Auto Body. That's where I'm employed. We've been with us on since the beginning, 12 years now, basically. Work right into Haney Construction, who's my second primary sponsor. They've been on with us, I think, about 7 years now also. Lube Express here out of McHenry. Dahl & Wagner Heating and Cooling out of McHenry. We have Radicom out of McHenry. Let's try to get them all. We had Road Rage Signs. They're out of McHenry also. And then we have Performance Unlimited. Denny's basically a product sponsor. Helps out a lot. A lot of knowledge comes out of his shop. We use his shop when we need to get everything done, especially wintertime. And we've also helped Denny out quite a bit with his chassis business going on here.
And that's gone rather well for you. Now, that I know Denny gave you a lot of help on that Millennium car last year, picking up that championship at Lake Geneva Raceway, racing against guys like Tommy the Shark Novoso, Al Papini raced with you guys last year, or actually 2 years ago, before you were in the series. Just a great number of guys. Now, you think that's really going to take off?
That, it looks like it will. I kind of backed out of it, and one way I wish I wouldn't have, but we looked at it and wanted to go with a super late deal and program. Super late. The Millennium deal is really a cost-effective way to go racing. I ran all year on 8 tires. You can't do that in any, you know, premier division. So they got everything on control. You're going to run, you know, a sealed motor, which makes the racing just like the IROC series. It didn't matter what night you got out there. It was competitive racing. I mean, some nights there was only 5 cars out there, but it was a toss in the hat who was going to win out of the 5 guys.
Yeah, a lot of good competitors out there in that field, as well as super lights at Lake Geneva. I was looking at guys like Joe Too Fast Fisher, Al Schill comes down and runs with you guys every once in a while, Kent Burkhoff up every once in a while, trying to run out of Pell Lake. Now, coming out of McHenry, Illinois, the guys down here, what is it? Is there something in the water down in this McHenry area?
Nah, it's just Lake Geneva's been there, and you got your Illinois boys, and it seems like quite a few of us come out of McHenry area. And it's kind of when you see one guy doing it, everyone wants to do something. And with the performance shop right here in McHenry, it helps out the local guys knowing where to go and what to get as far as performance. And you just kind of, you see stuff and you want to do it. And we do all the car shows in town and stuff. So there's a future for the little guys when they start seeing the race cars around in the area. And it's been that way ever since I've been in this area.
Sure. Now let's flash back to your beginnings. I remember about must have been 12 years ago now, we saw you up at Lake Geneva in a super late model. Actually, that time it was a limited late model on 8-inch Hoosiers, very limited motor. I think that's where you got your start. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, we've been out. We've been crewing for Dave Milan for 2 years, and Dave hurt his back one night, and I don't know if it was a whole deal that I hurt my back or if I wanted to sell a car, so he had me drive. Climbed in a car, had some practice time in it, and went out and won a first heat. We ran everyone off the track to do her first heat. They couldn't pass me because I used up the whole track being my first time in a car. But I was hooked from then on out.
Now, I remember that year, maybe some creative engineering on that machine, some holes drilled in the bumper cover that created just a little bit of a stir with the remainder of the competitors as well as the tech inspectors.
Well, that was back in then, it was a Thunderbird we had, and the SSC Thunderbird did have aero coupe holes in the back to let the air out, so we just said it was a 5-star SSC Thunderbird, and we cut our own holes in the back to match the factory ones. Well, the tech inspector, he thought different, and we had to plug him up that night with duct tape, but for a rookie driver, that wasn't making me fast.
No, not at all. Just a lot of flat-out skill?
Oh, no, not at that. We got the skill in the last basically 5 years. We developed a real good knowing of the car, the chassis, and everything. I wish I knew now what I could take back 10 years ago when I started. We might have really went somewhere with racing. But as the age is setting in, we're just having fun and enjoying ourselves.
And what do you have planned for this year?
This year is going to be a full season at Lake Geneva. We finished fifth, tied with Fisher for the fifth place finish. We're going to round this year, tried for a full year. We definitely want a top five again. I'm going for the championship. If we get there, we get there. We've been in championship battles before, and we know what it takes to win them. And that's why we're going with two full cars and set up this year strictly for Lake Geneva. We're also going to get out there and do some slingers, get up and do the Wisconsin Challenge Series, try to run a few of the other shows, because it makes a driver out of you when you travel. I traveled for 4 years, and I know what it takes to do that traveling deal. But Lake Geneva is a nice track, and it's close to home.
Sure. Now, you know, speaking of the traveling thing, the traveling that you did with the Mid-America Series, rather tough on you trying to get from one track to another week in, week out, chasing down Gary Recoudering so you can keep on top of him, keep on top of that points battle. Now, that Mid-America Series, that's gone a long way. It's come a long way. The skills that you learned in that division, helping you out quite a bit today?
Yeah, it has. You learn to adapt with the different tracks that you run with the Mid-American. You're there only for a short practice session. Your last notes maybe were 6 months or a year ago from that track. So everything you have to do is right away, spontaneous. It makes you get to know the car and get your guessing done right away. Now at Lake Geneva, yeah, you stay weekly there. The cars you develop, by the end of the year, you should have a super fast car.
You would hope so, at least.
Yep.
I wasn't really going to mention it, but beginning of the year, we started off, and there was a cupcake, heard a rumor going around that that's what we should call you, and you had asked me nicely not to call you that. Worst mistake you could have made, because the following week I did repeat that once again. We kind of tracked back on that, and we kind of kicked back just a CC. Now, at the end of the year, we had a little fun up there at Lake Geneva at the October Classic. Why don't you tell all the fans where that name Cupcake came from?
Well, that name came from Denny's wife, Michelle, down here, and just basically, out of spontaneous, just called me Cupcake, and I kind of laugh at it, and I don't know, as a nickname, as a racer, I didn't care for it, so I told Dave here, you know, you call me Cupcake again, I'm going to have to give you a cupcake in the face one day. And so Dave, you know, he thought about that and said, hey, Rick's bigger than me, and I'll not take that challenge. The last night of the season, we kind of had it all set up. Wayne Freeman set fast time with the super late, and I sat fast time with the Millennium, or Limited Late, up at Lake Geneva. So during Race Fest, we're down for interviews, and we got Dave with a couple cupcakes right in the face, and he no longer calls me Cupcake in public.
No, I still call you Cupcake. Oh, we've had a lot of fun over the years.
Yes, we do.
It's what it's all about.
Yep, if you can't have fun, there's no use going up there.
Exactly. You know, and I would imagine that through your experience, you've always focused on that fun angle. I know that you guys hang around after races quite a bit. Relax, kick back, talk to your fellow competitors. Is there anyone that you don't feel, you know, is having fun out there? I don't want to put the pressure on you to, you know, say it's Joe Fisher.
No.
He doesn't stay nearly long enough.
No, Joe. Joe actually stays around. Joe's going to team up with me this year. We're putting up a new shop at my house. We'll be running both his super late model out of my shop and running my two cars. And there you got two competitive teams. We tied for the finish, and that's called having fun. When you can take two teams together, and we traveled together and camped out together up at the Dells, and that's where when you have fun, it's doing that way. There's some guys at the track that take it too seriously. They're not there to have fun. You got to have fun. When you have fun, winning will come.
That's right. That's definitely right. Now, let's kind of look at the setup on the cars. That's kind of progressed for you as well from your time in the limited late miles to the time now with the super late mile. Setup's the same?
The setup, we found you have more devices on the car to work with than what we're used to with the sportsman car. Beginning of the year, we were playing with too much, and we kind of lost the setup on the car. We got back into it and just went back to the basics that we've learned. Leave the setup in that left-hander gives us, tweak it just a little bit where you need to, and we finished the season out real well. I mean, we ended up having a second-place finish at the end of the year taken away, and then during a big race fest, we ended up finishing fifth, I believe it was.
Well, that's very good, and against a lot of good guys, too. Todd Cleaver had come down, Al Shield had come down, Kirby Kurth. You know, you've got a lot of experience running with a lot of big names, but guys like that who have been traveling a long time, you kind of alluded earlier to the fact that, you know, you get a lot more experience. How was it running with those guys?
Those guys, it's fun. I mean, we went up to what you call Kirby Kurth, up to his home track at Plover, ended up finishing ninth up there in one of their 100-lap main events. You know, first time up there in a super late. We had been up there in a Millennium or a Mid-American car and set fast time, had a track record for a little bit up there until they repaved the track. But you're familiar with these tracks when you get out, and it helps with that. But these guys that come down to Lake Geneva, it takes them a little bit to get used to the track. I mean, Al's been there for years and years, and he knows when he comes in what his setup is going to be and how to approach the two corners. I mean, it's two different racetracks.
Sure, now you've pointed that as well. Lake Geneva, very unusual in your opinion?
Yeah, it's the hardest one of all the tracks I've been to. And we've probably been to about 15 different tracks throughout the upper Midwest here.
What is the hardest point about Lake Geneva Raceway?
Well, one and two is banked progressively coming into it. Three and four is progressively debanked, so the banking runs off to a flat track in a front stretch. And if you need to win, you're going to learn three and four. If you just want to run average, you set the car up, you run one and two, you're doing fine. But to pass and win, you got to be on the bottom, come out of four, and keep it sticking down there.
Sure. Now, of all the favorite tracks you've gone to, what would you point to as your most favorite track?
Probably down in Missouri, I-70. That was just a beautiful facility down there. Cedar Rapids out in Iowa, another top-ranked facility. La Crosse is nice, Kaukauna's nice, Milwaukee, Chicago. They're all up there, and, you know, as far as what they're like and stuff.
So pretty much you're telling us they're all your favorite.
Yeah, we won on most all of them, so when you win on one, you got to have that your favorite.
There it is, Rick C.C. Corso, looking for that championship coming up here in 2002 at Lake Geneva Raceway in the Super Late Mile, now teaming up with Joe Too Fast Fisher. Hopefully he can take it home and make the wife proud.
Well, we plan on it.
Rick, thank you for coming down today.
Thank you, Dave. We'll see you opening night.
You betcha.
And the double checkers are out to Rick C.C. Corso.
We're down here with Joe Too Fast Fisher out of Johnsburg, Illinois. Joe Fisher running at the Lake Geneva Raceway in a super late mile division. Joe, I'll tell you what, had a great season this year.
I had a I had a season to remember, that's for sure. The car was fast, but we had probably the worst luck I've ever had, and that's the way it goes sometimes. Sometimes you get good, sometimes bad.
But you still ended up tied in for fifth in points with Rick Corso.
Yeah, I was happy with ending up fifth to an extent. My goal was a top five. I didn't figure on being able to win a championship this year. I'm still trying to gain experience. But fifth was our goal, and we met it, and it was an even better thing in the end when we tied with our good friend Rick Corso.
And that was really a great duel you guys had out there on the track. And you had a lot of great battles this year, and the one that really comes to mind is that the October Classic at Lake Geneva Raceway right there at the end of the year. You started inside front row, right on the pole position. Unfortunately, you had Wiley track veteran Al Schill Sr. right alongside you. Behind you, you had Lake Geneva Raceway champion Landry Potter, and alongside of him, he had Conrad Morgan. You're really brushing the elbows with the greats up there in front in that race. Unfortunately, I think problem sidelined you in that event as well.
Yeah, they did. I was really, actually, for the first time in a long time, I was pretty nervous about going into that race. Being that, number one, I'm sitting on the front row, the biggest race of the season, you know, on the pole nonetheless. Also sitting next to Al Schill, Conrad Morgan, Landry Potter. These are all really, you know, quality race drivers. But, you know, I held my own. We got the lead away from Al right away and ran away with it for a little while. Unfortunately, we had a little mishap. Had the lower radiator hose come off the pump. That put me out of the race. But sometimes that happens. Like I said before, the luck was not good this year.
That's right. But that was okay, because the experience that you gained during that event, you'll be able to capitalize on it this year.
Sure. I was just, like I said at the interview before the race started, I was just going to try and show those guys that I belonged there, you know, that I could race with them and to gain some respect from them, if nothing else.
And that you did, that not only that day, but throughout the course of the season. I think a lot of people kind of caught by surprise maybe a little bit that the number two car was on the move as much as it was this year. You've shown glimpses of speed in the past, but this year you really come a long way. Moved into a new chassis last year.
2 years ago we put a new chassis in it. Last year we finally moved up into the 21st century with a concept engine, a dry sump engine. Prior to that we were running the old Geneva compression motor, which was you know, just not quite up to par with what everybody else had. So once we put some horsepower with the car, you know, with a good chassis, it really worked out well.
Now, as I pointed out, you've got a lot of experience in a lot of different different series and on a lot of different surfaces. You used to run a dirt car?
Yeah, I ran at Wilmot for a little while in the late 80s. I also ran at Hales Corners in a dirt late model. Those places are a lot of fun, but, you know, to deal with all the dirt and believe it or not, they wreck a lot on the dirt, so I'm having a lot more fun here
but
on the asphalt.
Not as much as you wrecked this year.
No, probably not. Nobody wrecked as much as I wrecked this year.
And still finished fifth in the points.
Hey, I'll take it. We ended up fifth in the points, and the whole season I only won one race, and that was a dash. So it was consistency that got me there.
And you also have a championship underneath your belt, maybe not as a driver, but as a crew member.
Yeah, I was crew chief for Bob Gears for probably 5 or 6 years in the early to mid 80s, or 90s, I'm sorry. And we won the Sportsman Rookie of the Year. And the next year we followed it up with a championship. So, yeah, I got a championship of sorts.
No, it still counts because you still worked on the car.
Sure.
Bob may have drove it, but you guys had to keep that thing running and run to the front.
Yeah, it was good experience, you know, doing that. That was my first experience with asphalt, so it was invaluable as far as what I do now.
Sure. And now, yeah, as I pointed out with Rick earlier, you do have a lot of great guys helping you out up in the pit area. Your car owner or car co-owner, I guess.
Yeah, Scott and I both, Scott Popenhagen and I both split the bills on the car, which are quite a bit, as you know. I also have some other crew members, both of Scott's brothers, Mike and Rob Popenhagen. Their father helps us out in the pits also. And we got another friend of ours, Joe Amore, helps us in the pits as well. And then, of course, there's the girls. You know, you can't ever forget the girls. They're the ones who allow us to do this, and that's Julie and Tammy, Kathy and Julie. And of course, Barb. So,
and of course, they wouldn't let you forget.
Oh no, they would never let us forget.
Now that, you also have a lot of great help from a lot of great sponsors as well.
Absolutely, most of them being here from the McHenry area. My primary sponsor is Werf's Industries, right in the middle of McHenry. Been there forever. They do welding, and they also upkeep all the fire department fire trucks. Basically, for the whole Midwest, you know, they're the primary. A facility for repairing and upkeep on all the fire equipment, fire apparatus. Then also we have naturally Performance Unlimited here. Denny does a lot for us, not only here at the shop but at the track. He's an invaluable piece. I mean, without him, it would be a lot harder to get parts. And just having the facility here, having some of the tools that he has, that helps us out a lot.
Well, that's excellent. It's great that you have those people to help you out. Carrying on through season. Now you're looking next year, heading back up to Lake Geneva as well?
Yeah, we're going to run Geneva, I think. We're definitely going to start there opening night. We're going to see what happens. As far as whether we'll run the entire season, I guess that depends a little bit. We're also going to try and sling her a little bit, too. We'll just have to see. If we make the decision to run Geneva the whole season, it'll definitely be, you know, we'll give it our all. We'll be going for a championship.
Excellent. And maybe pick up another feature win this year?
Oh, I'm hoping so. I mean, I had multiple wins last year, I was on my way to multiple wins last year, but always something would happen. You know, one time I got spun, another time some body parts come loose, and, you know, little things like that, they happen. And there's nothing you can do about it.
That's right. But you always maintained a good attitude about it, maybe a little cranky after the races. But in reality, afterwards, up in the bar, we'd talk a little bit and realize that, you know, sometimes things happen that are out of your control. Maybe looking this season, maybe to get a little more of that control back into your arena?
Yeah. I'd like to say that I could always control my own destiny. But, you know, on a racetrack, there's 20 other guys out there, 19 other guys out there that you can't do anything with. I mean, you can't control what they're going to do, and you never know. And it's not as if someone's taking me out every time. It's just little mishaps here and there causing problems. But like you said, after the races are over, you got to let it go. We're all there for fun. And if you're not there for fun, I don't know, then you're probably taking it a little too seriously.
Now, Lake Geneva, you've been there for a few years. Been racing with a lot of great guys. You've raced, as I pointed out, with Al Schill. You've had opportunities to run with Kent Burkhoff. You've had opportunities to run with Mike Vogt Jr. Who out there is your toughest competitor?
Well, my toughest competitor is probably Rick. Rick Corso. The two of us run really close together, so we always seem to be near each other on the track. I mean, luckily, we both respect each other enough that very rarely would we ever touch. But you know, the heavy hitters up there, you know, you got Landry Potter. He's two-time defending track champion, or non-defending track champion this year. Of course, Al Schill shows up now and again. Jamie Wallace is as tough as they get, you know. And you've always got guys like Kent Burkhoff and the new guy, Wayne Freeman.
Sure. Now, that's great. Now, I understand that you're going to be moving into a shop with Rick this year?
Yeah, Rick's going to build a shop, or at least we're going to help him build a shop out at his house in Johnsburg, and we're going to have his two cars there, and we're going to have our car and our stuff over there too.
That's great. They're going to help you out a lot, you think?
I think so, because basically, you know, if something were to happen to one car one week and the other cars, you know, came out all right, I think that the two teams will get together and for sure make sure that all cars are ready for the following week by helping each other out.
Kind of looking at the Jack Roush mentality.
Yeah, I don't think we're quite the Jack Roush, you know, level yet, but
maybe we're
working on it, you know.
There you go. Yeah, maybe next year you'll have the four-car team.
Yeah, maybe four.
Yeah.
We'll have to see.
But now there's a lot of interesting things going on over the course of the off season. Looking forward, you know, hearing a lot of guys. If you had to choose someone other than yourself or Rick to win the championship next year, who would it be?
Are you asking for a favorite, or are you asking who do I wish to be the champion?
I'm just asking who you think will be the champion. It's not going to be me.
In my opinion, I would believe that that Jamie Wallace probably has the upper hand on most everybody. He's got the most experience. He's already got a championship under his belt. He knows what it takes to get there. And on top of that, he's pretty fast.
And you're hungry.
I'm hungry. Rick's hungry. We're all hungry. Everybody in the top five, I guarantee, is hungry.
Now, you had mentioned the fact Landry Potter moving up to that ASA ride next year, doing eight races to start off. That's something maybe that you would kind of hope for one day?
Absolutely. You know, naturally, like Rick said, you know, we're all getting up there in age. I mean, not that we're old guys, but the thing of it is that as far as marketing and sponsorship goes, you know, as you can see, these teams, the big teams in the world, they're looking for young guys. Which every year that passes us by, you know, we get a little bit older. But, yeah, I mean, every one of us, I think, wishes or aspires to be, at least in, you know, if not in the ASA series, at least, you know, get into a Remax car or get into a Busch car, ARCA car, anything, you know, to move up and make a living out of it. That would be great.
Would you like to make a living out of it?
Absolutely. Sure. I think I enjoy working on my race car and driving my race car more than anything. You know, that's what I do. That's all I ever think about when I'm at home, you know, other than my wife and kid. But that's important to me. I would love to try and move up.
That would be great. So hopefully we can see you do that someday.
I hope so.
Well, if all the cards are played out correctly and, you know, championships come your way and wins come your way, you may have an opportunity to do that someday.
I hope so.
to the outside. Fisher, the leader in the first lap.
Bob Moeller, legendary driving superstar, making his return back to the Lake Geneva Raceway this year. Bob, moving back down into a super stock this year after your performance in a super late model. Going to be driving back in the number 74 machine again?
Yeah, that'll be the number.
Going to be driving for Denny this year?
That is correct.
For Performance Unlimited, it should go pretty good for you?
I would think so.
You hope so.
He's the man.
A lot of good cars coming out of Denny's shop over the years.
I have seen that.
And that's pretty much the reason there?
Yeah, Denny and I had talked, and he approached me about driving a car for him, and it's starting to materialize now. So
starting to look good.
Starting to look good.
Now, how did that come about? Denny just talked to you? Did you approach Denny?
Actually, Denny approached me, actually, and mentioned he wanted to get another street stock, excuse me, back out on the track, and I said, by all means, I'm in. So.
Now, you are a former champion in that division. That was 93?
1993.
A long time ago.
Yes, it was.
Now, you moved back up into a super late model for the 2000 season. A lot of experience gained there?
Oh, yeah, quite a bit. Didn't do real well, but we definitely tried.
But so. With one of the prettiest super late models I think I've ever seen, the beautiful silver and orange machine.
Well, you're about the only guy that said that, but I appreciate that.
Now that was a relatively good year for you. You had a lot of good runs. You had to come through a semi a few times. But the budgetary concerns were really the issue?
Yeah, that was it. I just couldn't afford to do it on my own. That's what it was. And it was, you know, lack of quality equipment.
But now this year, this should really help out because you're going to have that good quality equipment coming out, Performance Unlimited.
Definitely. Definitely looking forward to it.
Good. Excellent. And we're really looking forward to seeing you win some more. You've had a lot of experience in that super stock class over the years. A lot of good drivers coming out of that moving up. Unfortunately, you're going to kind of step back a little bit, take a look at the program, run with those guys again this coming year.
Yeah. It's changed a lot since 1993, there's no doubt about it. And it'll be a learning curve for me, too. I'm going to be a little rusty.
But practice will make perfect.
I think so.
So you think you guys got a real good shot at the championship?
That's what we're shooting for. That's what I'm focusing for.
You got to look out for fast track Jack Rubach, though.
I heard about that.
You heard about that?
I heard about that.
You've been up there, you've been watching some races, drinking some beer,
Oh, yeah.
You think you got something for Jack?
We're going to give it our best. I think we do. I really do. Denny builds a quality street stock, and it's been proven. So I'm looking forward to it.
Now, you have mentioned that things have changed quite a bit from 1993 to 2002. What are the biggest changes that you see in the sport?
Just the quality of car. There's a lot more into it. Back in the day, it was basically, you know, break the glass, you know, gut it a little bit, put some rated coils in it, and go. And what they do now, I mean, it's unbelievable.
Now, you've seen that technology progress. You think you got a pretty good handle on that, especially after having that experience in the late model?
I think it'll help, definitely. I think I'm definitely I'm with the right people as far as, you know, racing this car. I got the right guy building it, and I think we're going to do good.
Now, who are you going to have working on the car week in, week out?
There's actually one guy, Scott Christensen is his name, and myself. And that's it, two-man band.
And the sponsors on the car, are you going to have a lot of financial help on that?
Well, obviously it's Performance Unlimited and Snap-on Tools, so.
Helping you out.
Yeah.
That really goes a long way. Now, back in 93 when you were racing, how did you get involved in the sport to bring yourself to the point where you were able to win a championship?
Basically just talking with other people and seeing what they're doing and practicing, you know, week in, week out.
Watching a lot of ESPN, learning how to be a race car driver?
Yeah, I wouldn't go there. The local track, obviously, but a little bit of luck, too. So.
Now, Lake Geneva, you've been up there for a few years, had that experience in the super late model, the experience in the super stock, in the street stock. What makes it such a hard place to race at?
I'd say there isn't a corner that's the same. Everything, you know, each corner's different. And there's a lot of room to pass on that track, a lot of three wide, and it's eventful.
Now, I'd asked Joe Fisher earlier about what makes a real race driver over just an ordinary race driver. Now, what do you think makes a real race driver, makes a winner?
Patience, knowledge, good attitude, and having fun. I mean, that's basically it.
Drinking beer afterwards.
Well, of course. That goes hand in hand, obviously. Yeah, definitely.
So you're really looking forward to getting back out there again next year? And we look forward to seeing you as well. And now hopefully you can pick up a couple of wins. Now that division itself is just
going to be tight.
So competitive. You know, this year Mike Cooley picking up second place in the points. You know, looking through the field, I don't think there's a bad car out there.
No, there isn't. There really isn't. It's a tight field. It's going to be a good competitive racing, which is enjoyable. I enjoy it, and everybody I talk to does too. So.
Now, if you had to pick one driver out there besides yourself who's going to win the championship next year.
Got to look at the Rubach. Got to look at the Agabrex. That's pretty much it, I think.
Just Jack and Scott, huh?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Maybe yourself.
I hope so.
Pick up a couple feature wins?
We're going to try.
That's right. Well, we're down here with Bob Moeller. Bob, I'm really looking forward to seeing you move that number 74 Performance Unlimited Snap-on Tool Chevrolet Monte Carlo to the front. Hopefully you can do some business up front and maybe clinch yourself a championship.
I sure hope so. We're going to try. Thank you, Dave.
Thanks, Bob.
You bet.
In the fifth spot. Two lanes for second. Moeller's going to bring it into four. Burkhoff backs out of it. Fisher takes over second. Your winner, Bob Moeller, and Joe Fisher, Ken Burkhoff, Russ Blakely, Jane Bishop.
We're here with Scott Egerbrecht, driver of the number 3 GM Goodwrench Chevrolet Monte Carlo. Scott, you had a great season last year.
Thank you.
Looking forward to getting back into the seat once again?
Oh, yeah. I can't wait.
Charge through the field once again, try and pick up a couple more feature wins this year?
Yeah, I'm going to try getting a lot of feature wins this year.
Feature wins are good.
Yes, they are.
Now, where'd you get started in this sport of ours?
A good friend of mine, way back when, had a car I bought off him for $50 and goes, hey, you got to try this out. So that's how it all took off.
What year was that?
It had been like end of 1987 I picked up the car.
Now, you've been around for a long time at Lake Geneva. You've seen a lot.
Wait a minute, not that long.
Well, it's been long enough that I think it's a long time. You had some great runs, had some good runs to the front, picked up a few feature wins over the years. Now, who in your mind is next quality driver coming out of Lake Geneva Raceway?
Well, like Bob said, Jack Rubach's a good driver. I like the way he drives, clean man. Going to have a lot of fun driving with Bob this year. So it's going to be some tough competition out there. We got Dave Milan to run against and a couple other boys out there. So we'll have a good year.
Think you'll be able to finish really good in points championship maybe?
I hope so.
Now I understand that you've got a brand new car that you're working on right now.
Yes, it'll be changing number. It'll be number 64 for next year.
Good, 64? No.
Yep.
So we're not going to see the legendary number 3?
No. Time to retire the 3.
So you're going to call up Dale and make sure you get that number placed in there so you don't end up with a
64 E? Pretty much. Yeah, we'll get that straightened out. We'll go back to the old 64 I used to have. That was my original number. I like to stay with that. A lot of good luck with it, so kind of superstitious with that.
How'd you end up with that number?
It was the year I was born. I had to start out somewhere.
So you end up with 64. You're going to run it again this year.
Yeah.
Got a lot of guys helping you up in the pit area?
Pretty much, I think I'll be having John Jansen help me and Daniel help me out a little bit and maybe a few other guys, but pretty much I've been doing it on my own for a while.
Now the knowledge you're going to be getting out of Denny and John, both former track champions at Lake Geneva in the Superstock division, just got to be overwhelming.
Oh, it's great. You know, I try to teach them everything I know, but,
but they
kidding.
They still
right, they're
on.
A little thick-headed, but we'll work it out.
Well, that's great, you know, that you're going to have those two. And like I said, you know, they've got a lot of feature wins, a lot of experience, a lot of knowledge, yourself with a lot of knowledge. Mm-hmm. Bob going to be helping you out. You know, I've got to think that that's going to be, you know, something very special for you to put that all together.
Yeah, so I'm very excited about how this is going to turn out because, well, basically me and Bob would probably be teammates over the summer on this, so be the 64-74 team back in doing dual again. It's like it used to be, so I'm looking forward to it.
There won't be any team orders, will there?
No, just have a lot of fun and get through the night and see you at the beer line.
So Denny won't get you two together beforehand and tell you, you know, if you guys are racing together, you know, don't take each other out or anything?
No, because we'll be working on them Sunday and Monday, putting them back together, and then seeing you on Tuesday for parts.
Exactly. There you go. But over the years, you've seen a lot of things go on, had a lot of fun, just great races. What is your most memorable event in your racing experience?
My favorite time is probably running the Run With Your Brung show and then going out. This is when Greg Potter and a couple other guys, Kent Berkoff, was running it, going out there running 20 laps and passing them twice in 20 laps. That was the most memorable time. That was fun. And I always look forward to that race in the years because, man, you just do whatever you want to the car and everybody has a good time, and it's a lot of fun.
That was the old weapons days.
Man. Oh, yeah. Good old weapons.
And then, where we've now progressed onto from a weapons car to a street stock to a super stock. Technology's really changed over the years.
Oh, big time. The parts that are available now for these cars is just awesome. I mean, you can really make a nice machine with what's out there right now from compared to what was before. I mean, before you're just taking a car, blowing the windows out of it, and doing a little front-end work to it in a roll cage. Now it's a lot more than that. I mean, you're really putting a nice machine together. You pay attention to the, you know, people running up front, and they ask a lot of questions. That's the main thing. Get to know everybody and find out what goes on out there, and you can really build a nice machine.
You mentioned a lot of parts.
A lot of parts. I'm talking like getting parts from Performance Unlimited and Five Star, and that's their main sources right there. Just asking Denny for a lot of help, and you can put a nice machine together and be competitive with everybody else.
Now, Denny's going to be one of your sponsors this year. Who are your other sponsors?
I have Signs Now. They're my sign sponsor out of Crystal Lake. Ron's Service out of Crystal Lake. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head. There's a few other smaller ones.
Well, there's so many people that help everyone out in the racing field. It is often hard to remember every last one of them.
Right, right.
And I'm sure that you feel the same way, that, you know, if you have neglected anyone.
I'm sorry.
Apologize, and you'll be sending your check back immediately.
Yes, I will.
Unfortunately, if you make a check out to them, don't cash it right away.
Yes, I'll hold that for 30 days.
Yeah. Now, you're looking forward to getting into this season. As I'm looking back, we're looking at April 6th this year for opening night. You going to be able to pull something off on opening night for us?
I hope so. Maybe a good solid win. Fast time would be awesome. I'd pray for that all day long.
Now, of course, as you mentioned, a lot of good drivers out there in that field and tough competitive fields week in, week out. The quality of cars has grown over the years.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to be looking into the future, though. What are you looking at for 2002 and beyond?
Basically, to get through this year of my car, possibly next year, and then we'll see how things go from there. I got some other plans and a couple cars I'm trying to put together just for high rods and stuff. I need to finish those projects, too. But
so the off time away from the racetrack is
okay,
still
you're getting at what we're going to do in a couple more years here. That would be nice to get into a super late. That'd be a big jump, but got to go step by step. So I think a sportsman car would be nice to do after this. If I can get enough sponsors together, I'd like to do a super late.
Do a super late.
Mm-hmm.
That raises the bar one more level. And technology, as we spoke about with the street stocks, that bar has raised over the years. The bar for the super late model, you think you'll be able to climb over that hurdle relatively easy?
That's why they make ladders.
That's very interesting, that you're looking to do that. Now, you look at someone like Landry Potter, who next year is going to be moving up in that ASA racing division, doing 8 races, kind of exciting for him. And you've raced with Landry.
So yeah, we used to race door-to-door. We had a lot of fun. We're pretty good friends, and we had a lot of good times.
Well, not only door-to-door, though. It's also been fender to quarter.
Fender
to
fender, quarter, wheel to wheel.
a lot of controversy back in those late 80s when you and Landry were racing together.
We had a lot of fun.
Yeah. And now Landry, among one of the toughest competitors at Lake Geneva. And I would gather, that not only, a competitor, but also a friend.
Yeah, we've had our differences in the past, but we keep in contact with each other and stuff like that. And I wish him the best with, moving on up. I hope he does well in it. I really look forward to seeing him moving. And
maybe you can slide into that ride.
Oh, I don't know about that. We'll see.
Well, that's good, though, that you're looking beyond, looking to move up and get involved more. Now, you'd also mentioned Greg Potter. The Potter name up there, just kind of synonymous with that whole street stock.
Yeah, it was like the Hatfield McCoys, Potters and Agerbecks back then. So it was a lot of controversy, and good friends with Greg and Landry Leroy, and had a lot of good times.
Really getting in, settling down, and learning. For both of you, though, it was really a learning experience. At times then, as you said,
mm-hmm.
Knock the glass out, just go racing, And Landry trying to take that move on. Greg had moved on as well to an IMCA modified.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be looking to do the same, hopefully, in a couple of years if everything goes your way with sponsors.
Right.
If things in the sport were perfect for a driver to just start, where would he get his start to
Would it be in a weapon style car? Would it be in a big car? Would it be
for somebody just, yeah, if they didn't have a lot of knowledge of what racing was all about, yeah, that'd be the way to go, to start out in a super stock car and just build up from there and ask lots of questions and ask for a lot of help.
Now, yeah, you say, you know, ask a lot of questions, but who do you direct those questions to? Do you look for the fast guy and just immediately go to him, draw to him?
Yeah, you basically go to the track, watch who's fast, and start asking those guys that are always running up front, you know, ask them, how do I get into this? What's involved? What do I need to do? What are the fast cars? Who do I need to get parts from? You know, just keep going from there. And you start accumulating stuff, then you find out how much everything costs, and you start, you know, get your money together, start building a car.
And do you have to be a little careful about who you're getting that information from, do you think, sometimes?
Sometimes you can get the wrong information. Sometimes you can get some really good information. It all depends on how much. Yeah. It just all depends on, you know, who you get your information from. Doesn't hurt to ask.
That's right.
You know, when in doubt, ask.
That's right. If you thought that this year you'd win a championship and just quit and never race again,
I couldn't do that.
So you wouldn't make that exchange?
Well, racing's in my blood. I can never quit racing. If I have to race a unicycle, I will race a unicycle. If that's all anything I can race, that's what it'll be.
We'll probably have to bring that up to Kevin next year.
Unicycle racing. Don't take it up, Kevin, because I can't even stand on my own 2 feet the way it is.
Unicycle races with the Blakely 500.
There we go.
There you go. Right after racing, we're all going to go up and race around the bar on unicycles. We'll have to take Kevin up on that. Scott, I tell you what, it's really been a pleasure having you down here. I tell you what, we're looking for big things out of you next year.
Thank you.
You know, hopefully that Performance Unlimited machine will just move right to the front.
It'll be running up front.
Well, hopefully Denny and John will be able to get that thing all worked out for you. I appreciate you coming down.
All right, thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
Here comes Huber on the inside, challenging your leader, car number 3, Scott Engelbrecht.
We're here with Denny Norton Jr., the owner and proprietor of Performance Unlimited in beautiful McHenry, Illinois, and competitor at the Lake Geneva Raceway in the Sportsman Division. Denny, a lot of experience through the years in a lot of different cars. Got yourself a championship.
Yeah, but that was a while ago, and this is a new class, and we spent a good part of this summer eating a lot of humble pie, so.
Getting back into it, though, feel good?
Yeah, I mean, we've got a lot on our plate this year with, you know, having the tire deal now and still trying to race a lot of guys. You know, at the beginning of the year last year, we weren't certain we were going to be able to do both. And thanks to, you know, my cousin Scott and my crew and a lot of my other friends, Rick, Joe, Scott, Bob, John Jansen, I mean, a lot of people really pitched in and helped out a lot so I could still race. Some too stupid to climb out of the car just yet, so.
Now, you did allude to that tire deal. Finally, you got the Hoosier tire deal, Lake Geneva Raceway.
Mm-hmm.
Moving them tires, got a lot of guys coming on over.
Yeah, I mean, it really helped out with traffic. You know, we were probably dealing with maybe 15 or 20% of the guys at Lake Geneva Raceway on a regular basis. And then when you get the tire deal, you're dealing with darn near 100% of the guys at one time or another, either coming in your trailer or coming to the shop, because second most consumable thing in racing. So.
And it also relates right directly back to the point of purchase sales, you know, guys coming down for tires as well as a lot of other things. And you're also a dealer for Lane Automotive, I believe?
Yeah, we've been a dealer for Lane for years. This year we picked up Left-Hander, Five Star. We're doing business with them now, and we appreciate all these companies coming on board because it gives us more of a variety of product for our customers and, you know, helps us make money, bottom line. So.
And allows you to go racing.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of a catch-22 because the more I take on, the busier I get, the less time I have for my own stuff. But if I don't keep working, I don't have any money to race. So.
Now, you started in off-road for four-wheel drive trucks?
Actually started racing monster trucks back in the mid to late 80s. And did that for a few years, got hired to race somebody else's truck, and hurt my back pretty bad. And my wife told me she really didn't want to push me around in a wheelchair the rest of my life, so we came up to Lake Geneva Raceway in 93 and we're watching those guys run around in the super stock class and decided to give that a try because I needed to race something. So
you started out in that really pretty looking black number 96 Chevelle.
Yeah.
Had a lot of fun with that car?
Yeah, it was great. I mean, we built it in 3 weeks, had maybe $1,800 invested in it, and at that time you could just about compete that way. And we came out one rookie of the year in 94 and you know, had a lot of fun. Started from scratch. We didn't know anything. Probably one of the first people I got to know at the track was Rick Corso, and he kind of pointed me in the right direction on a lot of things, and it really kind of sped up my learning curve. And a few years later, we were able to build a new car and win a championship with that. So.
And what year was that?
97.
97. That was with the Super Stock division.
Yep.
Running against guys, Scotty Cuxhaus, if I remember right.
Yep, Dennis Carlton, learned a lot from him. Unfortunately, he doesn't race as much as we'd like to see him run anymore, but he was kind of a quiet guy, but he was always smooth, fast, ran up front. So at the time, he mopped the floor with us in 96, so I watched him and learned a lot from him and figured, you know, if you're going to win, you have to be able to beat people like that. So.
Sure. Now then you moved, you decided to kind of retire from racing a little bit, focus a little more on your business?
Yeah, we took, my wife and I built a house and we needed to get things straightened out at the business, and we thought it was going to be a year. It turned out to be 3 years before we could finally put a sportsman car together, and then so last year was our first full season in a sportsman car.
Now in the meantime though, while you were quote unquote semi-retired, you were still actively involved up there with John Jansen.
Yeah, John Jansen came in and bought my car. I was real happy that he bought it because I knew he'd be competitive in it. And the year after he bought it, he came out and, you know, set the track record a couple of times, and he won the championship the following year.
Now, track record, I know there was a little bit of fun and games going on back there. You told a lot of guys that you would never break into the, what was that, 18
second? Well, at the time, you know, a fast time, well, when I started, fast time was usually like a 19.2, 19.3, and then I think it was Shane Bishop came out and clicked off 19.0. And then shortly after that, I came out and ran a 19.0, and it was actually Rick Corso and I. He had built a new sportsman car at the time, and he was talking about trying to get into the 16-second bracket in the sportsman car, and I was trying to get into the 18-second bracket in the street stock. And so we had a little rivalry going on there, and I think Kevin Rogers actually got wind of it, and he told me there was probably no way a super stock could run in the 18 seconds. Well, two weeks later, we came out and ran the first 18-second lap and spent a great deal of time in the tech shack after we did that. But we came out legal. He knew we were on the up and up, and since then, you know, now with the way the competition stepped up in that class, I think there's five or six guys who have since run in the 18 seconds.
Sure. Now, and that's the technology, you know, it has really progressed over the years.
Well, it's just the nature of the sport. I mean, you're always figuring out ways to go faster. I mean, probably in that class, there was really a significant change from, you know, the mid-90s to, you know, now 2002 season. You know, we had, when I was racing, there was maybe two, three cars that were capable of running in the sub-19s. Now, you know, the pole of your dash is a 19, high 19.1, low 19.2. So you got six guys within the same 0.2 seconds. You know, that's about as competitive as you get.
Sure. Now that sportsman division that you've raced in last year, did relatively well in it last year, I might add. Right there at the end of the year, you were very competitive with the Mid-American cars that came down for the Fall Classic. Mm-hmm. You had the one bad incident with Gary Lamont spinning backwards through the grass, kind of clocked you pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, that's just racing. I mean, those things are going to happen. I think I had a year comparable to Joe Fisher's year. You know, it seemed like if something bad was happening on the track, I was directly related to it. And but, you know, you just keep working at it. You just try to keep your chin up and keep smiling. Our goal was a top five in points this year. We actually missed it by one. But we were only, I think, 80 points out of third, you know. So it's a real competitive class. Some good drivers in there, you know, that have been around. You know, you got Mike Lang, who won the championship, Zach Derringer, who's capable of winning a championship, Brian Baker, Jerry Freeman, and there's any number of guys coming up next year. I think John Fisher's putting the car together with the help of Scotty Ports, so, you know, he's going to be competitive. And, you know, if Gary comes back, he ran well for the short time he was in a car. So there's a lot of guys that are real capable of running up front. It'll be just as tough, if not tougher.
Sure, I believe you pointed out to me that there was no driver in that division that had won more than two features during the course of
the
year.
Yep, nobody won more than two features, and there was nine different drivers, and we don't run a full schedule. I think we only have 14 races or 16 races during the course of the year. So
now you're going to be looking for that top five this coming year?
We're going to try like crazy. You know, it's the last full season I ran, except for in the Sportsman, the last full season I ran in a street stock, you know, we won 10 features, and then to come out and not win any was you know, definitely a big helping a humble pie. So it's harder than I thought. Rick's experience in a Sportsman's helping out us out a bunch. In fact, I should have listened to him when we went to Milwaukee. he told us to do something. We did something different, and it hurt us out. But his experience helping us out, we kind of, you know, again, our learning curve is shorter because we had his notes to go off of, and, you know, he had 10 years in one of those cars. So.
Now, that input that you're getting not only from those guys directly related to you, but also the guys that you know at Lake Geneva, as mm-hmm. well as the run of Mid-American Series, got to be helping you out as a driver.
Yeah, it's one of the good things about being in this business, because I know so many different guys, and there's, you know, there's so many different ways to accomplish the same thing. I mean, as Joe was talking about earlier, him and Rick run side by side on the track, but I'm certain you ask them what they run for setups, they're probably a lot different than people would imagine, but they're still getting the same thing done with them.
Now, you had mentioned a bunch of guys that helped you out, allowed you not only to race, but run your business, run the tire operation at Lake Geneva, mm-hmm. and I know you got a lot of great sponsors.
Yeah, I mean, we've had a few over the years. One of my good friends came from through racing, Marty Robb at McHenry Limo, has been with me for 4 or 5 years now.
And Marty, winner of the shopping cart
yeah,
race.
Yeah, winner of the shopping cart race, yeah.
Legend.
And I have that. Jim Adams Auto Body's always painting my car for me. We have Andy's Macco Tools is always on it. John Jansen got a couple of guys. Barry's Bar came on board this year, helped us out a bunch. Blake and Schaefer Excavating right down the street. So there's a lot of good people on board. So.
Sure, and I know those guys are up there every week cheering you on, having a good time. I know Barry's up there. I see Barry quite often. And I know you had that big racers party down there at Barry's earlier this year.
Yeah, we just tried to do a little bit. At the end of the every year, we have kind of a customer appreciation party. And it started to outgrow my house. And Barry's got the facility to have that. So we thought we'd pay him back a little bit and, you know, invite everybody down there at the sure. end of the year for some free beer and pizza. So
that's great. Now this coming year, you're going to be running the Sportsman again?
Yeah. Probably, if all goes well, we're going to run this. This could be my last season in a Sportsman car before I'll take a little bit more time off. If it goes well, I'm trying to get it set up where I can have a few different cars and have people driving for me. You talked about Moeller earlier. That Super Stock is real competitive class, and I wanted to get a, you know, a car in that, so we approached Bob about driving because, you know, he's a heck of a race car driver and just doesn't get to have the equipment that a lot of other people do. So we figured we start him in that. And if it does turn out to be my last year in the Sportsman car, I'd probably hire somebody like John Jansen maybe to drive it for me while I'm hopefully down the road put a super late together. And, you know, if Rick and Joe don't leave, maybe give a chance to run with them a little bit. So
maybe they'll both retire.
No, well, they will just to avoid me, I think. So.
Now, you know, I know a lot of this is about having fun, and a lot of it's about family and friends. Mm-hmm. And I know you've got your father here that helps you, you know, on a regular basis.
Well, he built this business. I mean, he just is, you know, he's tired. He worked his butt off for 20 years getting this thing started. Now it's my turn to hopefully accelerate it from where he's got it to. And, you know, he just try to move forward with it. And like I said, this last couple of years has really been a whirlwind, you know, picking up Hoosier and Left-Hander and Five Star and a lot of those great companies that, you know, all the races are looking for those products. And now hopefully I can give them a place to come get that stuff.
Sure. And we also see Michelle at the track every week.
I couldn't do it without her. I mean, she's the one that counts the money and constantly reminds me of the things I'm supposed to be doing. And, you know, she takes care of a lot of that. It'd be impossible for me to keep organized without her.
Oh, that's great. Now, you mentioned the late mile.
Mm-hmm.
Would you be driving that, you think? Or?
Yeah. Well, again, I'm too stupid to do the right thing and let somebody else drive it. You know, I'd like to at least try everything.
It's almost a disease, isn't it?
Yep, it's a sickness. You know, I watch a lot of people I know in this sport have raced, you know, and most of my good friends now are directly related to the sport. So it's twofold. You know, one, I want to do it because it's fun and I have a good time doing it. Like Joe says, it's all you think about when you're a race car driver. You wake up thinking about racing, you go to sleep thinking about racing, and, you know, I just, you know, eventually I'm sure I'll probably step out and just be an owner and have guys driving for me. You know, there's a lot of great race car drivers out there that just don't have the equipment, and I think I'd like to go out and find some guys and maybe help their careers along a little bit. So.
Sure. Oh, yeah, there are a lot of great race car drivers, you know, across the country. But, you know, it seems right here in the Midwest that we've got a lot of great names. You know, Trickle came out of here. Musgrave came out of here. A lot of fantastic guys. Who's your hero?
You know, I really don't have one guy. I mean, everybody, it's different racing, you know. Of course, I thought a lot about Dale Earnhardt because of not so much what he did just on the racetrack, but what he did in his life. You know, he came from nothing and built himself a pretty good business and was a great race car driver. But there's guys around here that, you know, given the same opportunities, the same equipment as these guys, even in Winston Cup, you know, they're no different. I mean, there's guys who could be just as competitive. You know, you got Landry Potter, hopefully going somewhere with his ASA ride, but, you know, guys like Joe, Rick, Bob, even down in the street stocks, John Jansen, Jack Rubach, you know, you give all these guys a chance with the good equipment. I think there's a lot of these guys that would surprise you and be able to run with anybody.
Sure, that's great. Denny Norton finally realizing, or not finally realizing, I guess, but realizing and letting us all know that the true heroes in the sport are the short track drivers.
Yeah.
Denny, I really appreciate you having us down here today. Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Just remember, you can contact us at frpracing@aol.com. Keep up to date with all the local racing action with www.racingonline.com. We hope you enjoyed this edition of Midwest Motorsports Review. For Dave Kamholtz, this is Daryl Franklin. We'll see you at the racetrack.
DeKester trying to come up in the orange machine. DeKester into the back end of the 61. Up and over the top. And flipping. Landing upside down the 6 machine.